Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining today's joint briefing at the Jerusalem Press Club with the Jewish People Policy Institute. My name is Taya Dekel, CEO of JPC. With Israel nearing the end of its six-month war against Hamas in Gaza and Hezbollah in the north, among other security threats it faces, controversial legislation over the military draft places cleavages between communities right in the middle of the national agenda and threatens the shaky emergency unity government. While the cabinet meeting to approve a version of the bill has been postponed, the government must submit a final version by noon to the High Court. With us to share some context for this uniquely Israeli predicament and perhaps shed light on the likely political implications of whatever decision is reached are two experts from the notable think tank, the JPPI. Chairman Shuki Friedman, Dr. Shuki Friedman, is a member of the Faculty of Law at the Paris Academic Center and served as secretary of the Locker Committee for examining the defense budget. Rivka Ravitz is a fellow at the Institute whose research focuses on empowerment of ultra-Orthodox women in the labor market and is herself a member of the community. Dr. Friedman, let's begin with you. So the arrangement being examined time and again is based on the original status quo agreement made by state founders. Before we delve into the current situation, can you briefly give us some background of this concession to yeshiva students from serving as stipulated by the security service law?
Yeah, sure. Actually, we are now in a record number of ultra-Orthodox that exempt from service in the army. There are approximately between 63 and 66,000 ultra-Orthodox that learning Torah and not tending to the army, not drafting. And historically, it began actually with the state of Israel being established by Ben-Gurion, but the difference between Ben-Gurion time and today is the numbers. The ultra-Orthodox today are 13.5% of the Israeli population. Prediction is saying that in 40 years or so, there will be approximately a third of the Israelis. And we all realize that if we can't bring them on to join to the rest of the Israelis, taking the boarding of security, army service, and joining also to the workforce and be productive, Israel will not be able to continue to be at least a prospering state, and it may be worse. Now, in the recent 20 years, there's been a tremendous efforts to bring ultra-Orthodox to the army since the Tal legislation about 22 years ago. And since then, three times the Knesset tried to legislate a law that will bring them to draft them to the army. And it failed again and again because this law has been actually revised by the court that ordered that they are not align with the values of equality, and in practice, all efforts to bring ultra-Orthodox to draft the army in failed so far. So we are now on 2024, 76 years of existence, and unfortunately, a large amount of young people not serving the army, and in the wartime, it's become much more crucial for us to bring them in and to join us these efforts.
Very clear. Thank you for that. Ms. Ravitz, what are the main concerns posed by the Haredi communities, and I say communities because I know they're diverse, when it comes to serving in the military, if you can play that out?
So yes, so I'll touch this. You could get all the numbers and the details and the law and the numbers of years, 35 or 22 or things like that, that you could get from the press. And Shuki gave a good summary of that. But I want to tell you what's the feeling of a mother, of a Haredi mother, about this issue. And it's not easy in these days that we are in a war. And we see soldiers get killed and funerals all around of us. And the feeling is really not so comfortable for each one of us. But I must say, you know, I must explain it because there's a very important moment in the week. And that is the moment when a Jewish mother lights her Shabbos candles. And we prepare a lot for that. We clean the house and we cook and we dress our children very nice. And then all the family stands around the candles and the mother lights the candles. And then she has just one prayer to say next to the candles in this one special precious minute of the week. She just asks God to give her boys that learn Torah. Why do I tell you this? Because I just want to explain what does learning Torah mean for a Jewish mother. And saying that, we all understand that we must take part and there's a war and everything is understandable and we understand it. It goes without say. The question is the way and the politics around it and how could we do this without going to politics and without ruining the community and having a problem with our children. I have a cousin that went into the army and he was still Haredi. And when he came out, he was not Haredi anymore. So it's a really concern. It's a real, mothers are frightened from that. And still saying that, as I said, we want to give part, we want to be part of. We're not parasites, as people call us. So it's a very not easy question and issue in the Haredi community these days.
I just want to take you from the end of what you said and ask you if what are these alternatives that you are referring to when you talk about sharing the burden if it's not through the military, and is that something that's being trickling down from the leadership to the street, or does it come from the bottom up? How does that work?
So there's a problem with the IDF as a word in the Haredi community. As I said, people are afraid of sending their children into the IDF, but they are not afraid of sending their children into the police or Shirut Ezrachi or things like that. They are willing and wanting to give part and take part. But the other question you asked is a good question, because the rabbinical institutes are afraid even of those solutions. So that pretty much comes from bottom up. And I believe it's supposed to come from the institutions, from the rabbinical personnel. And we have to find a way to solve it. I'm sure there's a way to solve it, I'm sure. But the problem is it became such a political issue, and it's so hot and it's so much troubles around it. So I'm not sure if in this moment and in this situation we could solve it, but for sure we could. There's a solution and a good one, and it has to come and we have to talk about it.
Okay, so we'll get to the solutions in just a minute. I do want to take you to the political side of things and what we might be looking at. The bill aims to cement exemption for Haredi men and would actually extend the service of non-Haredi soldiers, as we've seen, raise the age of reserves and so forth. The defense minister actually warned that he wouldn't present it to the Knesset for a vote unless there was unanimous support from the coalition parties, and we've already seen coalition members shaky. We saw that Minister Gideon Saar already abandoned the unity government. We saw an ultimatum being issued by Benny Gantz. And all of these things weaken Netanyahu's coalition. Dr. Friedman, what do you think these steps are going, how are they going to impact Netanyahu's next move? What is the political scene going to look like over the next few days, weeks?
Before we delve to politics, just to perspective on comments on what Rivka said. It's clear that the ultra-Orthodox community afraid of serving the army and their concerns of keeping their identity while serving the army is understandable. But the army is the IDF have solution for this. It already, I know the fact that the IDF already started to initiate further possible solutions to this concern and enable the ultra-Orthodox to serve in separated units and bases without women and so forth. So it's it's possible to find the ways for them to keep their identity on one hand and enable them to be part of the IDF on the other hand. But more important, I think, is the fact that up until today, including the new draft law, we are talking not with the ultra-Orthodox individual, but through the communities, by quantities and quotes and so forth, makes the discussion or strengthens the ability of the leadership of the ultra-Orthodox to have an impact on the issue and block any effort to draft the ultra-Orthodox, because the leadership doesn't want, not the political leadership and not the spiritual or rabbinical leadership, doesn't want the ultra-Orthodox to go to the army because it will hurt dramatically their power on the community. Now, the state should change its way of thinking, the political system and the public. We're not talking with community. We're not collecting tax for a community. We're not talking with community. We're talking with individuals. You should go to the army, individual ultra-Orthodox young boy. Now for the politics, it's clear for many years, it seems the ultra-Orthodox have a veto on governments. And in this government, they have a strong ability to actually have an influence on its political future. And Netanyahu, for years, lying with the ultra-Orthodox and buys them in a way by financing the yeshivot and buying their political support in his continuous administration for many years. And in this point of time, it's clear that if he will break this alliance with ultra-Orthodox, his government might collapse. He wouldn't have enough support to continue. And therefore, from his perspective, he will give them everything they demand. He already started before the war and gave them a full exemption from drafting to the army for the whole life. Now, everybody knows that in the coalition, there's some resistance, Gallant and Gantz and others. But more important, everybody knows that the High Court of Justice will again revise this law if it will be submitted in the way it's been drafted now, because again, it doesn't stand in any standard of equality. And therefore, what happened is that politically, we are in a very sensitive weeks where Netanyahu is trying to keep his power by supporting the ultra-Orthodox, enabling them to buy time. If there will be enough individuals, members of Knesset, from the coalition that will reject this, in my perspective, not fair and not reasonable law, at least in time of war and always as well, I think there will be a huge political crisis, and it's hard to predict if there will be any compromise or not, but I hope that in some time in the near future, we will find enough politicians and enough brave politicians to make the historic change and draft the ultra-Orthodox to the army.
Is that a likely scenario in the current makeup of the government? I'm not talking about the parties that joined from the opposition because of the war, but of course, Netanyahu already had a government prior to the war. In terms of the current makeup of the government, do you identify any members there that will suit this definition, as you say, that will understand its importance and possibly bring down the government because of the current legislation? And if you can also add, what are the current aspects that Netanyahu is trying to get through in order to keep the Haredi parties satisfied, that would be helpful for our listeners?
Yeah, so basically, it's hard to predict how the individuals of the Likud that express some criticism towards the draft law will in the day of voting will vote. But Gantz declared that he will not present the law and reject it, and Gantz as well. So there are some opposition to the law already, and it's really, it's very fragile. The majority is 64. If there be another 4 or 5 voters rejecting the law, the government colleagues from on Netanyahu's side is trying to actually find some compromise that's been tried in the past, sort of a quotes of drafting some ultra-Orthodox to the army in the next 2 years with very, very minor economic sanctions, something that ultra-Orthodox already agreed to in the past, and everybody knows would not pass the court. But if he will manage to find a compromise that will satisfy them and satisfy the potential opposition within the Likud, he will manage to bypass this crisis for the time, for now, up until the court will revise it and will take, and this is what's important to Netanyahu now.
Okay, thank you. Rivka, Dr. Friedman mentioned that he thinks that there is some kind of, potential to figure out solutions for integrating Haredim into the army in a more successful way than has been up until now. Do you share this optimism?
I share this idea that we could find a solution. I'm not so optimistic about finding it right now because of it becoming such a political hot situation. People are like feeling so. I am optimistic about being able to find a solution, but I hope it could be done at these days and at this situation. Don't forget, it's also a war, so everything together it's not an easy situation.
But isn't that maybe a catalyst when you look at the fact that many times crisis, solutions can be born out of crisis, and maybe this is something that perhaps I don't know. It's not my community, but what it begs the question that couldn't this war, in which we saw the greatest massacre of the Jewish people since the Holocaust, provide some kind of catalyst within the Haredi community that perhaps serving in the army is something. Is a worthy cause that should be sought, whether it's alongside learning Torah.
So maybe that could be a catalyst for the solutions coming from bottom up. But what I see from coming up bottom from the rabbinical and from the institutions, it seems like the political situation just put each one in his spot, and people like are just standing on their spot and not moving. That's what I see.
Okay, this is clear. I'd like to move over to other communities that are relevant. We've seen opposition to these laws over sharing of the burden have traditionally been led by secular segments of society, but segments of the religious Zionist camp have also been recently heard saying that Torah learning lifestyle doesn't necessarily contradict the possibility of doing military service. And of course, we've seen the heavy losses that these communities have suffered since October 7th. I'd like to ask both of you how this will impact social cohesion in Israel in a post-war, post-judicial reform crisis area, when we have more and more cleavage between the various communities. And this is an unfortunately an excellent example of one of these issues that are ripping communities apart.
First of all, just comment Rivka's statement. Basically, when the war started, I wrote a piece saying that there is a hope for a change in the Ultra-Orthodox community. The bottom-up change, not the top-down. Top-down doesn't really happen. Bottom-up, maybe, there's a war, there's a threat. It's clear that the army is centrist, maybe an existential risk twist. And unfortunately, through this month, we've went through few polls towards
Dr. Friedman, I'm just going to point out that community your internet...
and find out that there have been very minor changes in the willingness to.
Dr. Friedman, I'm just going to ask that you make an effort to improve your connection. Perhaps somebody there can help you maybe reconnect to a hotspot, and maybe we'll go in in the meantime to Rivka to answer the question, and we'll come back to you when you've been able to improve your Wi-Fi, if that's possible.
Can you? Yeah. Is it better now?
Not really.
Is it better now?
The internet's better, but you're frozen. So let's try to fix that, and we'll go to Rivka for a couple of minutes. Thank you.
Okay. So I'll say that we are parted into four tribes in Israel, and probably into more of that. And this issue of going to the army is really the Haredi and the religious national don't think the same about it at no point. It has just two different things. And in this issue of taking part in the army, so Haredi and the team would mean national religious, we just think it's not the same at all. It's a mistake that people do, because the two of you are religious, the two of you have a kippah on your head, so what's, and two of you learn Torah and some means of but the Haredi type of learning Torah is going into yeshiva and giving all your life to Torah, and so it's really not the same, even though it's a mistake that people do.
Understood. Dr. Friedman, let's try you again.
Yeah, I hope the connection is better now. I changed the. Okay, so just to start and end with what I said, that basically there is no tremendous bottom up change in the ultra-Orthodox community. We see it through polls, and unfortunately, there's been a very, very minor change in the willingness of the ultra-Orthodox as a community, bottom up, to draft to the army, to go to the army. Basically, because majority of ultra-Orthodox doesn't think it's their duty. They've not been educated to think that it's part of their track of life on of civil duties to draft to the army. And this is something the state should be changed, because we can't rely on their leadership. Now, regarding the Israeli cohesion, you're right. I mean, there's tremendous streets on our cohesion before the war, and the streets are growing. I mean, the challenges of the legal reform and the question been separating the Israeli society before the war is not even disappeared at all. And the craft question is actually on all but much more emphasized question to might stir up the Israeli society, whereas the national religious, the Nudatit, is basically tempting to support in a much a larger rates the drafting of the ultra-Orthodox to the army than before the war. Before we have a continuous pause on the Tzionut Datit, the national religious group as well. And what we see is before the war, they've been support in accepting the ultra-Orthodox to the drafting the army. And now, immense majority, the Tzionut Datit supporting drafting the ultra-Orthodox to the army. Half of them, approximately 40%, also supporting forcing the ultra-Orthodox to go to the army. So basically, a tremendous majority of the Israelis, 80%, supporting drafting the ultra-Orthodox to the army, and only 10% or 15% from the ultra-Orthodox think they should go to the army. And this clarify what a huge gap we have here within the society between the majority of, I would call it the Zionist bloc, the people that serving, that are part of the labor force, that are care about the state, and the ultra-Orthodox that basically have a different and separate life within Israel in sort of a ghetto that their leaders are trying to strengthen and to heighten the walls of this ghetto. So to your question, definitely, we are confronting a tremendous threat to the cohesion. And when the wars will end, we'll find ourselves again in the streets demonstrating to draft the ultra-Orthodox and to go to election.
So Rivka, you're hearing the concerns that Shuki has raised now. And of course, these are polls conducted by your own institute. How would you respond to these concerns? I'm not asking you to advocate for the community, but maybe you can explain what the thinking is when hearing this, whether internally or externally?
So I'll tell you, we also feel concerned in the community. You could find it a difference between the politicians and the people, and between top-down institutes and the rabbinical institutes, but we are all also very concerned. At the same time, we don't want to give up a thing that we believe is a kernel of our belief, you know? So learning Torah is in the kernel of our belief. It's in our, and we still believe we could find some sorts of solutions. So I know Shuki went through all the numbers and the Chok Tal and Chok Shoked and all those 2012 and all those places. I really sat there. I was in the Knesset in those days, and I saw, and I could tell you, you know, a few sorts of members of Knesset in the Haredi community. My father-in-law was willing to do Chok Tal, and he even was one of the people who wrote Chok Tal, and his rabbi, Rav Shach, understood it, and he was willing to give it. But then came other kinds of rabbinical communities and people, and we the thing is, I as a Haredi mother in these days of a war, I don't have an answer to what would be here, what will happen, how could the law look like that the two sides will be happy with. I don't really have the answer.
Understood. I do want to ask something about whether the benefits of serving in the army is something that's being thought about as well in the community, putting aside, you know, the ethical issues of whose communities should serve. But Israel has traditionally, or the IDF has traditionally been perceived as a kind of stepping stone into integration into Israeli society, including creating networks between, you know, people in the future, gaining skills for the workforce. Is this something that is taken into consideration when deciding, is it a good place to be or a bad place to be?
First of all, yeah, it is taking into consideration in small numbers, not in big numbers. Also women. It's funny, you don't know, but there are, like, I don't know, a few hundreds of women serving the army as citizens. And there are some hundreds of boys too doing it through what we call Shmone Mataim, Bina Beyarok, Shachar Kachol, things like that. Yeah, that's a good place to be, and it has a good prestige in the community to go to. But it's very few people do that. Like, it's small numbers. That could be a good idea of a model that could work. But in these days, it works in not big numbers. Not a lot of people do it, but it has a prestige. Could be an idea of like working through that model that worked.
When the bill was drafted or is being revised, perhaps Dr. Friedman, you can weigh in on here. Is the future economic impact of Israeli Haredim being in the workforce as a result of them being integrated because of their army service something that's taken into consideration, or is this a purely military standpoint that things are being looked at?
No, basically, before the war, there's been a serious discussion in the Israeli society on whether to give up. There have been voices also from the left side and secular side of the Israeli society saying we basically don't need very large army. We need small and smart army, and therefore not necessarily need the ultra-Orthodox drafting to the army. Let's give them a full exemption from the army service and enable them to join to the workforce. So at least we would not lose their ability to be part of the Israeli prosper economy and be part of the workforce, because if we don't do this, we'll be in a lose-lose situation. We wouldn't get them to the army, and we wouldn't get them to the economy, and then they will not pay taxes, and one will not be part of the productive Israeli public. after the war, we realize that things change. It's not only about equality. It's about necessity for more soldiers through the borders. And we now, unfortunately, have to hold a larger army that we thought we need. It should be also smart, but we need more soldiers. And it's a zero-sum game. And if we don't recruit, we don't draft ultra-Orthodox, myself, my son, my friends, we'll have to serve more days in Miluim, in reserve service. And my younger boys are going to draft his army soon. We'll have to serve more months or year in the army instead of drafting the ultra-Orthodox. So we're not just talking about equality. We're talking about a necessity of security demands of the army to bring in more soldiers, to take this burden and to protect borders, and to let us continue and survive, but also prosper. And if we don't bring them on, the people that are serving and paying taxes, we have to pay more and serve more, and it's unacceptable.
As the mother of three boys, I share your concern. One journalist is asking if you can provide a specific timeline over the legislative table that we're looking at, and I'll add a follow-up question. Do you think we're going to be seeing arrests in the streets in terms of implementing the law at the end of the day, or is this just something that, you know, will dissipate?
You know, basically, the government should submit some draft laws soon, in the next few days. I think that up until the end of the month, and they just submitted a request from the court to give them more 10 days to negotiate. So basically, it should be happening very soon, and should accomplish this draft and legislate it up until June or so. So the time is very tough, and I think Prime Minister is focusing on trying to get any compromise in a very few hours, because they're going to vote on in the government, the cabinet, on the law now, today, I think, before Garland is getting back from DC. Basically, I believe that they will put something on the table. Otherwise, the court will order to block all the budgets to the yeshivot, which would cause the ultra-Orthodox to retire from the government, which is a crisis for itself. And then, so far, there have been some sort of patches to the or interpretation to the draft law that enable the government not to force it. But it's a good question what will happen in the near future. I assume we wouldn't see a mass arrests on the streets, but we definitely see or the collapse of the government or appeal to the court that will block the ability of the ultra-Orthodox community to continue this way, getting the budgets and so forth. And that will bring to a crisis, political crisis as well. So it's really hard to see arrests on the streets, but it's quite reasonable that we'll see a political crisis and also social crisis, because the people that serving would not accept any unreasonable compromise.
This would have been a good place to end, but one journalist has asked another question regarding ultra-Orthodox women, and asking that if the exemption is based on the study of Torah and there's no requirement for women to do so, why do they receive an exemption? Why is national service only voluntary and not compulsory? Mm-hmm.
So that's hysterical for all religious women, nothing to do with Haredi women, also national religious women. It's hysterical that women were not forced to go to the army. They were just volunteering. And it's because of like religious beliefs. And it goes also in Haredi community and also in the national religious. Today in Tzionidati, it's less and less, like more and more girls go also to very fighting units, but it's historical.
Rivka, do you share Shuki's assessment that this political crisis will be something that we're going to see on the Haredi street if a law is passed, if the government collapses. What's it going to look like from your point of view?
I'm not sure. I'll tell you why. Because it's a war. It's a war now. And even though I said that the rabbis are they stand on this path and they are strong in the belief. Still saying that they have the sensitivity. It's now a war. And you see a lot of, you know, it was just purring 2 days ago, and they said no dancing in the streets and no drinking and no things like that. It's a war. They were all so. In personal, I can't believe them sending out the boys to protest when it's still war and an issue like this one. But it's just my feeling. I hope we won't get there.
Very, very clear. Dr. Friedman, any last words?
You know, it's a historic moment. If not managed to bring in the ultra-Orthodox to be part of the society, to be part of the duty, but also the right to serve the army and protect the existing state of Israel, and to be part of the economy, in the long run, it will be very, very hard for us to continue this way and to prosper and even to exist. So it's tough days and tough decisions, but we need brave leaders to take them.
Absolutely. Thank you so much to both of you, Dr. Shuki Friedman, Mrs. Rivka Ravitz, and thank you to the Jewish People Policy Institute for your partnership. And may we have a quiet rest of the week.
Thank you very much. Have a nice quiet day.
Bye-bye.
And thank you to my colleague, Jonathan Beck, for facilitating this call.